Almighty God, you have given us this good land as our heritage. Make us always remember your generosity and constantly do your will. Bless our land with honest industry, truthful education, and an honorable way of life. Save us from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil course of action. Make us who came from many nations with many different languages a united people. Defend our liberties and give those whom we have entrusted with the authority of government the spirit of wisdom, that there might be justice and peace in our land. When times are prosperous, let our hearts be thankful, and in troubled times, do not let our trust in you fail. We ask all this through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. The Old Testament reading for this Sunday from 2 Samuel chapter 22, and we will speak the words of this text responsibly. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock.
Exalted be God, the rock, my Savior.
He is the God who avenges me,
who puts the nations under me,
who sets me free from my enemies.
You exalted me above my foes.
From violent men you rescued me. And the psalm for this morning, a portion of Psalm 67. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face shine upon us, that your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations.
Let the
peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us.
God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. And our epistle reading from Romans chapter 13. Paul writes, let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for rulers do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also as a matter of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we stand for our gospel proclamation. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 22nd chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then the Pharisees went out and laid plans to trap him, that is Jesus, in his words. They sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians. Teacher, they said, we know that you are a man of integrity and that you teach the way of God in accordance with the truth. You are not swayed by others because you pay no attention to who they are. Tell us then, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay the imperial tax to Caesar or not? But Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, you hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax. They brought him a denarius, and he asked them, whose image is this, and whose inscription? Caesar's, they replied. Then he said to them, so give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We now profess our Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for the hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, the title for our message this morning is Mint Heirs, and the text is our gospel reading from Matthew 22. I'm holding up in here in my fingers. You probably can't see it from where you're sitting, but it is a quarter And of course, we know whether you call it a quarter or 2 bits, it's worth 25 cents, right? But there is a slim chance that you might have a quarter in your possession today that is worth as much as $1,000. Let me explain. Starting in January of 1999, the United States Mint produced a brand new quarter every 10 weeks, celebrating each of the 50 states. And they released the quarters in the order that the states were admitted into the Union. So the first quarter was issued in January of 1999, and it commemorated the state of Delaware. And the final coin in the series was released in August of 2008, celebrating the great state of Hawaii. Well, things were going along just fine until October of 2004, when the Wisconsin coin went into circulation. That's when coin collectors across America stood up and took notice. Why would they do that? Well, let's just call it a mint error. Every time the mint produced a new quarter, it made about 500 million of them, and inevitably some mistakes would be made. Now, normally quality control at the mint would be able to pick out those mistakes. But in the case of the Wisconsin quarter, more than just a few of those quarters in error made it into circulation. Now, on the state side of the perfect Wisconsin quarter, you've got a cow's head, you've got a wheel of cheese, and you've got an ear of corn bursting forth from a husk, all very appropriate for the state of Wisconsin, right? However, on the error coins, there appears to be an additional leaf on that ear of corn. It's sort of half peeled away from the husk, if you will. Now, this is not a big deal if you're waiting in line to buy something at Walmart. I get that. But coin collectors have been eager to get their hands on these mint errors ever since. So I urge you, go home, check your piggy bank, check your wallet or wherever you keep your coins, because you might just have a Wisconsin quarter in there that could be worth up to $1,000. In our gospel reading for today, we see that the Pharisees were also interested in coins, but it was not because of mint error. You see, they used the most common coin of their day, the Roman denarius, to set Jesus up, to set him up for public embarrassment. In front of his followers, they asked the Lord whether it was lawful to pay taxes to the Roman Empire. Now, if Jesus argued against that tax, they would have accused him of leading a rebellion against Rome. On the other hand, if he endorsed the tax, the common people who hated the Roman overlords, well, they might view Jesus as being too sympathetic towards Rome, and they would stop following him. So, it was a lose-lose situation for our Lord. At least, that's what his enemies thought. Well, unfortunately for them, Jesus quickly turns the tables on them. He calls for his challengers to produce one of those coins, a denarius, and he asks them whose image is on this coin. And they gave the obvious answer. It is the Roman emperor. And Jesus taught them, give to Caesar then what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God. Our Lord not only turned the tables on his enemies, but he was trying to help his followers, that would be us, to avoid a mint error, if you will. And that would be the sin of confusing our responsibilities in the kingdom of God and our responsibilities as citizens of a kingdom of the world. In our text, Jesus makes it clear that we are citizens of both kingdoms, and therefore we owe loyalty and allegiance to both rulers. If Jesus was here in the flesh today speaking to us, he would say, render to Uncle Sam what belongs to him, and render to your heavenly Father what belongs to him. Since we are followers of Jesus, and because we're celebrating the 244th birthday of our nation this weekend, and all the freedoms that we enjoy as citizens, it's worth asking and thinking about this question. What are our responsibilities when it comes to being citizens of these two kingdoms? One way to answer that question begins with this rather unique confession. It's not my image. It's not my likeness that appears on my money. In the ancient world, coinage was a sign of ownership. When a new king arose to power, he would have new coins made with his image and likeness on it. It was a show of authority. Now, the last time I looked in my pocket, the coins in my pocket bore the image of Abraham Lincoln, Thomas Jefferson, FDR, and George Washington. And I think we would agree, all of them are iconic figures in our history. And the paper money in my wallet, not only Washington and Lincoln, but also Alexander Hamilton on the $10 bill, Andrew Jackson on the $20, Ulysses S. Grant on the $50, and Benjamin Franklin on the $100 bill. Now, mind you, I don't have a lot of those in my pocket. My image does not appear on any of it. Therefore, those coins and those bills do not ultimately belong to me. The reality is, everything that we have, including those coins and bills that we call ours, those are on loan from God. Because as we heard in our reading from Romans chapter 13, it's God who gives government authority. And forgetting that truth would be a mint error. So therefore, our observance of Independence Day is more than just a day off from work and to wave the flag, enjoy some good food, shoot off some fireworks. It also includes thanking God for the precious liberties that we have here in this country. Thanking God for those who have paid the ultimate price so that we can enjoy our freedoms. And asking the Lord to bless all of those who hold office, who have authority, from our president to our governor to our mayor to our representatives in Congress and our state legislators to our judges, all of them. Because all of these folks are gifts from God, and they bear his authority, whether they fall in line with our political beliefs or not. And Jesus' words, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, that's a call to each one of us to participate in our government by paying our taxes, the taxes that we owe. And by the way, the government has the right to levy those taxes, to obey the laws of our land, to make sure that we're doing everything that we can to keep peace in the land, to exercise our right to vote, and if you feel called, to run for office yourself. So it's Jesus' love for you and me that's so beautifully portrayed on the cross and at the empty tomb. That is what moves us to live as good citizens, to be the best citizens that we can be, to realize that citizenship in this world is a part of God's grace poured out upon us. Jesus also says, give to God what belongs to God. And by those words, we are reminded that we are citizens of another kingdom. It's an invisible kingdom. It's the kingdom of heaven. But you know, before we give back to God, we have to receive from him first. So I ask you this morning, have you received the riches of the gospel which are offered to you in Christ? Have you been forgiven of your sins? Has the burden of guilt been removed from your soul? Do you possess that peace of God which passes all human understanding? Do you have a clear conscience this morning? Are you certain that your spirit will go to heaven when you die and that your body will be raised gloriously on the last day because Christ died and rose for you? You know, there are no meant errors when it comes to God's plan. It's a perfect plan. There are no misprints, no mistakes, no blemishes. This plan is for every human being that has ever lived. And it says that Christ died on the cross and that he rose again for you, so that you can be a citizen of his heavenly kingdom. In his death and resurrection, you have been released from the power of sin and death and the devil. As a baptized child of God, you have a standing in God's kingdom. And when Christ comes again, you will reign with him in glory. Your spirit will be reunited with your resurrected body. And this he gives you as a gift, simply because he loves you, and he has this incredible plan for your life. That's pure grace. There once was a wealthy farmer who was pretty tight, shall we say, when it came to giving to his congregation. So his pastor went to see him, hoping to loosen the purse strings a little bit. And the pastor reminded this fellow that fertile land that he worked, and the rain and the sunshine that came upon it, and the fertile crops, the bountiful crops that were produced, and the money that he got from selling those crops, all of that was from God. And the preacher added this. He said, you know, this farm and everything you have on it is really on loan to you from God. You really should be more grateful. And the farmer thought about it for a minute, and he replied, well, I don't mean to complain, Pastor, but you should have seen what a mess this place was when God was running it by himself. We can all relate to that farmer, right? We've all had similar thoughts. Theologically, the preacher was right on. Everything we possess comes from God. But we tend to believe that our prosperity, our success is due to us. It's due to our brilliance or our planning or our college education, whatever it might be. It's sinful pride when we feel that we have accomplished something and we fail to give glory to God. Instead, we acknowledge that God is the source of all blessings. Without his grace and mercy, we would not be able to live as we do here in the United States of America, and also in his heavenly kingdom. So he is the king, and we make a mint error when we fail to recognize him as such. But when we do recognize his kingship, when we do recognize the grace that's poured out upon us each day, well, wonderful blessings follow. I'm going to take you guys as an example to the last chapters of 1 Chronicles. And there we have recorded David's preparations for turning over the kingdom to his son Solomon. You know, David, once he had gathered his, or once he had made his kingdom one and he had established his capital in Jerusalem, his plan was to build a temple, a permanent place of worship, because you remember they had been worshiping in a tent, a tabernacle. But God told him, no, you have too much blood on your hands. That task is going to go to your son Solomon. And so David did the next best thing. He gathered the materials that were needed for the job. He contracted with skilled craftsmen. He donated huge sums of his own wealth to the project. And finally, he challenged his people, not only to offer their skills and talents, but also their monetary gifts too. And the people responded generously. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, there's a prayer there, a very humble prayer of David. And he speaks this prayer after the people had joyfully accepted his challenge. And in this prayer, he cautions the people against a number of meant errors. First, unlike the kings of the surrounding nations, David ascribed to God the qualities that were normally used when speaking of a human king. This is what he wrote. "Yours, O Lord, are the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and on the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all." David also acknowledged that the people had not him, the king, to thank, but God to thank for their blessings. He said, "But who am I and what is my people that we should be able to make this free will offering? For all things come from you, and of your own have we given to you." David's prayer is a reflection of good stewardship, a recognition that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, and that we are both the users and the custodians of it. In Christian circles, we often use that word stewardship to refer to how much money we're going to give so that the congregation can meet its budget, and certainly that's a part of it. But the biblical sense of stewardship is much broader than that. It involves how we use everything God gives us. Our planet, our environment, our nation, our skills, our talents, our mind, our bodies. And our stewardship is practiced in direct proportion to our thankfulness and our gratitude towards God. And so it would be a meant error to think of stewardship as anything less than our whole life. And that takes us, as we close, back to the gospel. When Jesus shows his enemies that coin and he asks them whose portrait is on it, the Greek word that we translate as portrait there is where we get our word icon. A better translation of Jesus' question would be, whose icon is on that coin? And that word reminds us of one of the fundamental truths of our faith. If we give our coin in taxes back to Uncle Sam because his icons are on it, remember that's all the guys I mentioned earlier, then what is it that we give back to God? The answer is our whole self. Remember, God's icon, God's image rests upon us. We are made in his image and likeness. That's how he created us. And he has recreated us in the waters of baptism. And therefore, he deserves everything that we've got, our whole life, because it all comes from him. And that is no meant error.
Thank you.
We stand for the prayers of the church. O God, you are faithful even when we are faithless. Your compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Guide us through the strains and stresses of life as our hope is anchored in you. Hear us, good Lord. We praise and thank you for the men and women of our armed forces, and also for those who serve as police officers, firefighters, and other first responders. Be the strength of all those who courageously defend us from our enemies. Hear us, good Lord. That includes Violet Helwig, Kent Lucky, Judy Sears, Carl Jenny, and Ron Schrader. Forgive the sins of all who repent and heal them from all their diseases according to your good and gracious will. Hear us, good Lord. We especially ask you to bless Reverend Gary and Stephanie Schulte as they continue their ministry in Central Africa remotely from their temporary quarters in St. Louis. Keep them healthy, give them strength, determination, focus, and your vision for gospel mission in that part of the world. Guide all who vigorously make known your holy name to the very ends of the earth. Hear us, good Lord. Lord, we pray for the Holy Christian Church here in this place and around the world. Guide us waking and guard us sleeping, that we may remain steadfast in the one true faith. We celebrate with Dale Bronenkant, Ron Schrader, Peyton Lucky, Kelly Kohlfeld, Derek Miesner, Julie Petzold, Ethan Best, Dennis Leinbach, and Dalton France, who observe birthdays this week. We also lift up to you Mike and Alicia Anderley, Blake and Amanda Lucky, Nathan and Sarah Best, and Todd and Tammy Petzold, who observe wedding anniversaries this week. Hear us, good Lord. We especially pray for the unborn and for those who cannot defend themselves or care for themselves. Protect those who are frail, suffering in mind, body, or spirit, granting them peace and wholeness. Hear us, good Lord.
All these things we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling, and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, the Lord has remembered us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear the Lord, small and great alike. And so the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. You may be seated for the hymn. Once again, good morning to all. Hope you've had a great 4th of July weekend. Hope this topped it off here as we hear God's word and we celebrate what God continues to do among us and in our nation. And thanks to the men's choir, and I think that was Evan up there on the drums, right? Thanks for sharing your talents this morning. For the next two weekends, I will not be here. July 10th and 17th, Amy and I are taking a little vacation. So Pastor Benkendorf will be here next Sunday, and Pastor Wallenberg the following Sunday to fill in. We won't do the Friday service during those 2 weeks. I didn't ask them to do that, but we will resume the Friday 11 a.m. service for those who are not wanting to return back to normal, if you will. So totally understandable. That's fine. Portals of prayer are available, the July through September issue, back in the narthex on the North Buffet. The church supper news, I mentioned that last week. We're not having that this year because of the coronavirus, but we are asking each family unit make perhaps a $20 gift towards the mission and ministry of our congregation. LYF is still collecting aluminum cans. The money raised for that will send our kids to Houston for the next youth gathering in 2 years. So if you're wanting to do something with your cans, there is a great purpose for it. I think that's it. Go in peace, serve the Lord, enjoy your 4th of July Sunday. Oh, Bob, one more. Oh, thank you. Yeah, I guess we'll do what we have been doing. We'll do the balcony first and then work from the back towards the front. Thanks for reminding me.